to askthepastor.com?
Sure. Is it available? I doubt it.
Yeah, I don't think so, but we'll just pretend it's available.
Askthecrazyvancouverpastors.com.
That would be available.
That would be available.
Hey, we had a great conversation the other week on stage about kind of the conflicts that we have about the Bible.
It was kind of a conversation. It felt a little one way. I think I was...
You were a little chatty.
A little chatty, yeah. A little yappy.
Keep your answers down to 1 minute in this segment. Is that okay?
Do my best.
All right, so we promised our church members, there was a lot of people who asked questions via text message, and we said we would answer some of their questions over the next several weeks, so that's what we're going to do.
That is what we're going to do, and I'm looking forward to it because there's some great questions.
So what's one of the questions?
Well, one of the questions was concerning Sabbath and how Christians, and in particularly maybe Seventh-day Adventists who value the Sabbath as something the Bible talks about, how we might better understand that in light of today's world, and as we're going to see in the question, like even when you were born, it says, "I've been convinced for a while that the Lord just wants us to rest on one day of the week. It really doesn't matter which day. The seventh day of the week isn't the same for everyone anyway. I was born on a Wednesday, so that makes Tuesday the seventh day of the week for me." So, what do you say, Kumar? How do you handle that idea that any 24-hour period should be a sufficient Sabbath for someone?
Well, that's a very logical question that's being asked, especially with the birthday. That kind of makes sense to me. But in reality, I just kind of go right back to Genesis, the fact that God did create a Sabbath. And I think the point is, you do need a day of rest. We all are crazy people, and God knew that we would just work ourselves to death. But God did set aside the seventh day as the Sabbath. And if you think that Wednesday is your Sabbath, we'll think you're insane, but go for it. But I'm convinced that the Bible is very clear that the seventh day in a weekly cycle is the Sabbath. So whatever that seventh day is to you, go for it.
Yeah, and I think in a way, we also have to understand what that specific 24-hour period looks like and what did it stand for. I think sometimes we consider, let me use the example of a flag, as one of my favorite books on the Sabbath sort of reflects. Every country's got a flag, and every 24-hour period can kind of sort of represent a flag. And truth be told, the Canadian flag and, for example, the Chinese flag or, Egypt's flag or the U.S. flag, they're all flags. They're all sort of these rectangular designs, and every country sort of hangs one. And the flag sort of stands for the larger picture of what the meaning behind the flag is. So what does it mean to be an American? Well, 52 stars or 50 stars, 48 stars, it all has meaning. Mm-hmm. And the seventh day Sabbath, the one that, the Jews for all the way back into history, as far as we can go, and that Seventh day Adventists have latched onto, is a 24-hour period that stands for something, and it stands for the kind of God we serve. So it's not just this personal day of rest. If it was just a personal day of rest that we needed to sort of back away from everything so we don't go crazy, I guess any 24-hour period would probably do. But when we subscribe to the seventh day Sabbath, when we subscribe, we're subscribing to the kind of God and the kind of religious practice and faith that's behind that kind of Sabbath keeping. So things like social justice, things like creation care. Mm. It's not just...
Environmental
care. Yeah, it's not just us. Mm-hmm. God was for this planet. He was for us. And so understanding the Sabbath and its what some theologians call the portfolio of meanings, that flag in particular, the seventh-day Saturday flag, stands for something that other 24-hour periods don't stand for.
I love that. And just very pragmatically speaking, I just go back to what did Jesus observe? And Jesus was a Jew. And as you said, for thousands of years, Jews have... follow the Sabbath as their day of rest. Jesus did as well. And if it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me.
I just want to end with one short story. I live in the community here right around the Oak Ridge Church. And for those that are Vancouverites, they know that this is a heavily Jewish part of the city. And we have a lot of neighbors who on Sabbath mornings wake up with their yarmulkes and they're walking to synagogue down on Oak Street or wherever they are doing life together. And part of me just... my heart just sort of leaps for joy a little bit to know that we share in that heritage and that day is meaningful and has deep historical roots, and that as Christians in the 21st century, we connect to such an ancient practice that has so much ongoing relevance and meaning, and that you know, I'm a part of that, and that our little church here is right in the midst of sort of like Vancouver's Jewish community.
I love that.
And that we can share that with them is really great.
Hey, real quick, you referenced a book. I'm assuming it's Abraham Heschel's book.
Actually, no. Abraham Heschel's book's a great one, and I really encourage that one. I think it's just called The Sabbath.
Yeah.
But no, it's a Loma Linda professor named Sigve Tonstad that wrote a book called The Lost Meaning of the Seventh Day.
Awesome.
It's published by Andrews Press about 6 or 7 years ago, but it's dynamite. I recommend it to anybody.
Awesome. We'll add it right here, the lower thirds. Yeah. Right here.
Perfect.
Awesome. Hey, what are we going to talk about next week?
I think we have one more question, bro. Two questions a week.
But that was a long answer, so okay. It's kind of like just...
Well, this one's funny. When's the next potluck?
Ah! People were hungry, I think, and they were just thinking about food.
Yeah, the truth is we recognize that eating together makes a lot of sense. So if you're into it and you want to help us be creative and come alongside the team that's feeling at times like... We all say we want to eat together, but we're not always ponying up with the food. As pastors, we want to tell you, we're all for eating together, but bring some food, people.
Yeah.
We'll have more potlucks.
Yeah, and my slogan for potluck is, potluck, build your immunity.
All right.
If you've been in church member's home, you'll get that joke.
Yeah.
It's a bad joke. So when's the next potluck?
Mix and mingle, I think, at Easter there, the March 26th Sabbath. We're looking forward to that and want to invite you all to be there.
Awesome. What's our question for next week?
Question for next week is, how much Bible reading is enough? What does it look like to have a healthy devotional life? And can it be prescriptive? Can we prescribe a certain amount of Bible reading and Bible connection to say, hey, that's healthy and that's what it should look like?
I love it. All right, we'll talk to you next week and answer that question for you as well.
Welcome back to Ask the Crazy Vancouver Pastors Questions.
.com,
yeah. We're back here for week two, and we want to touch base on a question we raised last week, which was, how much Bible reading's enough Bible reading for one to sort of have a healthy... Good afternoon, OAC. It's Pastor Steve here, Friday afternoon. Just wanted to let you know that we want you involved at OAC, and one of the ways that you can tell us that you want to be involved is to download our app. If you've already got it downloaded, please click on the Get Involved link when you're on the main menu. Fill out the form, tell us what you're passionate about, and we'll get in touch with you and let you know how you can be involved here at OAC.
One, two. Good morning.
Whoops. It's on. Oh,
My bad. There we go. Good morning. Let's stand together as we worship the Lord this morning. Lord, we praise you for your unequaled greatness, Lord. Help us, Father, to hear your love song in every moment of our lives, that we may stop and listen to you more and less of ourselves. Amen. There's a song that we haven't done in a while, so we're going to teach you, remind you how it goes. It goes,
glory, glory, hallelujah, glory to the God of Israel. Glory, glory, hallelujah, and all the earth will sing that you're great.
Again, it goes,
glory, glory, hallelujah, glory to the God of Israel. Glory, glory, hallelujah, and all the earth will sing that you're a great God. Great are your works, great are
Turn around and greet someone at church this morning. Welcome those of you online. Thank you for joining us.
Examined my heart, and you know everything about me. You know when I sit down and when I stand up. You know my thoughts even when I'm far away. You see me when I travel and when I rest at home. You know everything I do. You know what I'm going to say even before I say it.
How precious are your thoughts about me, oh God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand, and when I wake up, you are still with me. just an outpouring of what you are already doing in our lives, Lord. And as some of us, I don't know why we're here this morning, Lord. You know that you've been calling. So just enter each heart, enter each walk with you this morning. Thank you.
Let's kneel and pray to our God. Love, so undeniable. Peace, help us to go deeper, Lord. They are the words of that song, pretty deep words, Lord. And today as a congregation, we kneel here before you on the Sabbath day. There's something about a Sabbath day that where the sun is shining, the blossoms are out, and the smell of the blossoms is just beautiful, and we can't help but think what an awesome creator God you are. And Father, we just praise your name for the church that we have, the opportunity to worship you in freedom. We take so much for granted. And Father, impress upon our hearts what a truly blessed and lucky congregation we are. Father, we just thank you for the country we live in. But we think of those that don't live here, that live somewhere where they're fearful for their lives and their families. And they're being persecuted for their faith in you. Lord, help us go deeper, not just in terms of our own faith, but in our support for those that love and serve you, Lord. Lord, may we pray for them. May you strengthen them. May you lift them up. May they feel like they have wings like eagles. And may they be comforted in this time and be faithful to the end, because you will give them a crown of righteousness. Father, we do ask for your spirit today and your leading and your guiding. On our hearts, to open our hearts for the message that Pastor Steve has to give to us this morning. Lord, bless him. May it not be his own words, but may it be your words, because you know what we need. You know the healing, you know the strength, you know the encouragement, you know the motivation that we need. Lord, may all the ministers in this church be blessed, Lord. May they have the courage to lead lives, Lord, that are inspiring for you. Lord, we're sent here to be salt and light, each one of us. We're all ministers. And we just pray that that spirit will grow within us as we spend more time with you on our knees, Lord, and in the Word of God. Draw us closer, Father God, we pray. We just want to thank you and we want to praise you that you hear our prayers and that you're a faithful God and that you love us and that you answer them. Father, we just pray that you'll be here and your presence will be here and that the devil will have no part in our lives, Lord. We ask for a hedge to be put around us. Lord, may this church continue to grow and may it be filled, Lord, and overflowing. May we be missionaries to the whole world, starting in Vancouver. We pray in your name. Amen.
Thanking the worship team this morning. Was that anointed or was it just me or what? What? Oh my gosh. I was just welling up. I don't like to cry in public too much every once in a while, but I just need to speak to you as a pastor just for a few brief moments here. Just being able to sit there and seeing a xylophone, like it you don't understand how important xylophones are. Just like thrilled to see a xylophone as part of worship. But more than a xylophone, to see Joey and Janessa totally lost in the presence of God up here, so obviously worshiping and just belting it out. The last 9 months has been refreshing to my soul to be able to come and worship here at OAC. I'm just so delighted. So thank you, worship team, for taking me a little deeper today. I don't know how many of you have your phones out, but I want to tell you a little bit about some of the discussions that have been going on. This is all sort of warm-up. I'm going to get into my sermon here in about 3 or 4 minutes. I just want to kind of bring you up to speed on some of the stuff that's been being talked about, you know, at various levels of leadership here at OAC. From the pew right on up to the board, we have been discussing what it's like to truly be a church where people can belong. And that word belonging can be sort of, at times, a vague word, you know, a word that means different things to different people. And so we're exploring how we can become a church that truly models belonging in a city that, that many people recognize is growing in its level of isolation. And one of the things that we've identified, and I want us all to practice here a little bit this morning. One of the things that we've identified is that one way that people begin to feel like they've got a sense of rootedness and a sense of belonging is when they can get involved in their faith community, at least in one little way. One little way. So if you have your phones, I'm going to invite you to download the OAC app right now. It's not going to take you long. Go to your Google Play Store or your iOS store. Download the app. And you might think that this is just Pastor Steve's little pet project, but it's not. There's a place there where you can click on Get Involved. Do it now. Do it now. I want to see my inbox full. It's all connected to my inbox and Peterson Masigan's inbox. And as you fill out this Get Involved form, you can tell us how you might be involved. So we could tap you on the shoulder and say, hey, we need a greeter, or we need somebody to help us clean up the papers out of the pews. Little wins, little things that you can do. But what we really want to be able to do is we want to be able to know how you might feel like you could contribute in some small way through an act of service to your faith community. So just search for Oak Ridge Adventist Church, download the app, and once you've got the app loaded, click on Get Involved. And right in the middle there, there's a blue tab. You click on that, Get Involved, and there's a form where you can fill out your name, your phone number, your email address, and then it just says, tell us your passion. Tell us your passion. Fill that out. Send it in to us, and our team will follow up with you and find a way for you to get involved here at our church. And then just another housekeeping item that I wanted to mention here. Let me just make sure I'm getting them all. With respect, you may have heard that we've been granted some money from the federal government to do a community garden. And so we're going to take that 90 feet by 21 feet right in front of that green hedge on our parking lot, and we're going to turn that 90 by 21 feet into a seniors accessible community garden over the next month. So as you drive in week in and week out, you'll see how this piece of land is being transformed. And what we need you to do is we need you to be ambassadors in your community as you encounter people that we're going to define seniors. Is anybody over the age of 55? Please don't throw any tomatoes. For those of you that are 55 plus and think, I'm not a senior, that's 65 plus. The federal government let us define it the way we'd like, so we're defining it 55 plus. And they will have access to 10 raised garden beds, there'll be a shed, there'll be seating areas, it'll be beautiful. We want you to know that we're doing this, and we're already partnering. I can't even tell you all the wonderful generative conversations that I've had with organizations and people in our community that are just thrilled that we're going to provide this kind of a community space here in the city of Vancouver. Now, why do I bring this up now in light of belonging and in light of you guys getting involved? This is just one other sliver in the pie of ways that when people walk by this church and they see a sign that says, welcome to whatever we end up calling the garden, we're in the midst of figuring that all out. But and they say, wow, look at this seating area, look at this food. And food and seating areas just sort of says, maybe I can tarry here a little while longer and just sit here in front of this safe, holy place, if that is in fact what it is. And we can put our arms around the community just a little bit more. So I hope you'll pray about that. I hope you'll pray about that community garden project. And I hope you'll download our app and tell us a little bit about how passionate you are and how you might give back in some small way to this church. And don't just think about the traditional things that, you know, churches need. Tell us about your passion, your genuine passion. And if you tell me that your passion is cleaning up little papers in the pews, you know, I'll come and have a conversation with you and say, I think there's something deeper. Tell us about how we might best serve you. All right, let's say a quick word of prayer and we'll dive into our message today. How about it? Thank you, Jesus, for loving us. Thank you, Jesus, for granting us this warm, safe place. Rex mentioned in his prayer, God, and I mentioned it too, that there are places in this world where people don't have the freedom to worship. And we do. And we don't want to take that for granted. So, Father, as your presence is here, draw us closer into your heart. I pray that my words and my actions and my stories and my teaching be wholly connected to what you're about and what you're up to in this world. We love you and we pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. It was the fall of 2000. I had graduated from high school in June of 2000. And it was approximately November, and I was attending Dougie Daycare, Douglas College, for those of you that are not Vancouverites. I was a music major, a music major at Douglas College, which basically means that I was a terrible musician. No, I don't mean that for anybody that might be taking music at Douglas College. But I just wanted to know more about music theory. I'd played guitar for a lot of years. Anyways, this is not really besides this. This is totally besides the story. I was a music major, and one day my telephone rang at home. And on the other end of the telephone line was a young lady's voice. And she said, I'm not sure we've met, but I think we've met. My name is Vesna, and... I'm a new Christian. Anyways, I'm having Bible studies at my house on Friday nights. Do you think you'd be willing to come? And I said, who are you? Come again? And she said, well, you know, I'm just this new Christian. I think we met maybe one time at a wedding. Would you be willing to come for Bible studies at my place on Friday nights? And I said, I'll think about it. So I talked to my buddies, my closest friends, and I said, you know, we've been having boys' night out now for like months on end, and I said, I think there's going to be girls there. I'm pretty sure there's going to be girls there. Do you think we can go? And of course, you know, 18-year-old kids, you know, girls were like, yeah, absolutely. So we went to this Bible study on Friday night to Vesna's house, and as those of you that don't know, Vesna's now my wife. And at 18 years of age, went over there to her place, and something clicked that night, and I had instant googly eyes over her. Instant. You know, it was not love at first sight, but definitely attraction at first sight. And for those of you that want to know what, never mind, don't go there, Markovich. Don't go there. Okay, so for the next several weeks, every single weekend, my buddies and I and Vesna and her friends, we would be going out on these group dates. Every single weekend, we'd be going on these group dates. Anyways, few months later, we found ourselves going to Berman University together, and about a year after that, I found myself proposing to her up by the river in Whistler, and about a year after that, so at the ripe old age of 21, we got married in the Westminster Church and had our reception down at that pink hotel in White Rock. You know the one I'm talking about, right close to 99 and King George, where they kind of kiss or whatever. Anyways, we got married at 21 years of age. But you know, all that time, all those group dates, all that time, first-year students at Berman University, second-year students at Berman University, what was at that point, Canadian University College. You know, one of the things that was never crossing my mind that whole time that I was getting to know Vesna was any kind of contractual obligations. I never sat there and thought, you know, I wonder what sort of a deal I'm entering into. Okay? As I was falling in love with this woman, I never thought to myself, you know, I wonder how I need to protect my own turf or my own rights and needs in light of this relationship. No, I was falling headlong into love with her, and we were doing life together. And as we were doing life together, feelings of trust, feelings of mutuality, feelings of camaraderie, and deep and profound respect were welling up inside of us. And it was these feelings of trust, it was these feelings of wanting to go to the ends of the earth for each other, you know, in this sort of pure, idyllic, young, teenage puppy dog love. It was these feelings that were motivating me to give my life to my wife, and that was motivating her to give her life to me. I didn't sit there, you know, the way that you do when you're sort of approaching a potential contractual obligation, where you sit to yourself, what do I need to put into this? And based on what I'm putting into this, what am I going to get out of it, right? I didn't think that. Not once did I really sit down and say, what am I going to put into this marriage? And what's Vesna going to be able to give me in return? at no point, except for maybe just before I proposed, did any sort of thoughts of like, how do I get out of this if this is a bad choice? Okay? I didn't go and propose to her and say, by the way, here's all the loopholes. Here's all the loopholes. Here's all the rules you and I must follow. And if we follow all these rules, then everything's going to be okay. But by the way, I've got a few loopholes here so that just in case, I've got an easy exit. Okay? By the way, it was a really rocky ground. And remember, I was only 20 years old and broke is a joke. So the ring was nothing special, gentlemen or ladies. Very, very basic ring. I never once thought to myself, oh, by the way, here, sign on the dotted line. There was no signing of the dotted line. There was just this idea that there was this promise. Notice the word, this promise that we were making to each other. This oath, this covenant that was built on trust, etc. It was not built on what I put into it and what I'm going to get out of it. And then just in case you don't follow up, you know, I need to have an easy exit. Why do I tell this story? Why do I couch it in the way I'm couching it? Because today we're talking about marriage myths. And for many of you that have gone through marriage or are gearing up for marriage, you know and you've experienced the idea that this is a legally binding contract in the province of British Columbia. And sometimes this paperwork and all this officiality that comes down from the, you know, Vital Statistics Agency and you get yourself a marriage certificate, you might view that marriage certificate and the form that you filled out there on your wedding day and signing away as some sort of a contractual obligation that you entered into. But I want to suggest here that when we view marriage as a contractual obligation, what we're failing to realize is that long-lasting, long-serving marriages are not born in contractual obligation to one another, but rather in caring, trusting promise to one another. So I want to highlight the differences between a contract and what the Bible calls a covenant. How many of you have heard the word covenant before? Yeah, a covenant is that thing that you do at a wedding when you stand at the altar and you share your vows. I've done a lot of weddings. I'm of that age right now where my friends are like, oh yeah, we've got a friend who's a pastor and he's young and he's energetic and we want him to do our wedding. So I've done a lot of weddings in the last 3 or 4 years, like a lot, which is the complete opposite of my first 2 years in ministry where I did like one marriage and like 15 funerals. I was in some old rural churches. But now I'm in some younger churches where I'm doing like, you know, 8 or 9 weddings a summer and almost no funerals. Hallelujah. So I used to, but my practice is changing. I used to say, you know, here's a list of vows. You know, here's kind of the traditional old school vows. Here's some updated vows. Here's some really modern vows. You know, and by the way, if you really want, you can write your own vows. But most of the time, people opt for vows that are already written for them. But my practice is changing now that I'm basically encouraging couples that even if they don't use the vows they've written, I encourage them to write their vows out. Do you know what writing your vows out does in a marriage? When you sit down and you write your vows out, what you basically realize is you're realizing the kind of promise you're making. Now, think of the traditional marriage vows and how they differ from a contract. In a contract, okay, let's take a buying a car example here, right? How many of you have participated in the car buying process at one point or another? Whether you're buying from a private owner and you're buying a used car from them, or you're going to a dealership and buying either a used or new car, there's a period of negotiation upon which you are establishing grounds for a contract. In exchange for this amount of money, I believe that you are presenting this vehicle in a certain way, whether it's a used or new car, and that this is what I'm ultimately getting from you for these dollars, right? And so this is what we call a contractual engagement. So you sit there and you negotiate. And, you know, so somebody says, you know, well, we'll throw in a set of mag wheels for you. What does that do to the contractual negotiation? What they're trying to do is they're trying to sweeten the pot, right? Oh, yeah, we just hubcaps, but, you know, to close the sale, they'll say, well, we'll put in some nice rims. Oh, okay, well. Now the contractual difference is, oh, you're saying, okay, well, maybe the asking price is a little more fair now. But you go back and forth, and you negotiate. By and large, I don't know of too many marriages, where couples sit down and negotiate what their marriage is going to look like. Now, does that mean that there aren't people that negotiate? Ever heard of a prenuptial? Do you know what a prenuptial is? Nuptials is the time where you commit in covenant to one another. And now, people are so afraid that this contract is definitely going to be broken that they specify basically what the end of the contract, when one of the parties fails to live up to their needs or chooses they need to get out of the contract, what that getting out of the contract is going to look like. So a marriage is not like that. So this is a myth that people have, that it's this quid pro quo, this for that. I give you this, you give me that. Marriage is not a contract. So let's continue to explore the difference. A contract is a legal deal between parties. A covenant, however, is a commitment involving the life of both parties. Okay, so contract is sort of like, here's my money, don't mess with my personal life. You know, I'll give you my money, you fix my teeth. Or I'll give you my money, you cut my hair. Or I'll give you this pie, you give me this loaf of bread. Okay, contractual sort of sharing of things. But a covenant is where you say, my whole well-being, my whole essence of who I am, the very integrity upon which my whole life is built is yours. You're not just offering a sliver of who you are, you're offering everything of who you are. This is a covenant. This is the covenant, and this is the kind of agreement in which you're entering. And by the way, marriage, another myth is that marriage is a 50-50 proposition. Marriage is not 50-50. And it's not even the cliche 100-100, whatever that means. It's like, you just got to think, I'm in this, I'm all in, I'm... It's just, it's your whole life. Contracts are very clearly delineated. You can go this far and no further, right? When you sign a contract with a potential employer, you say that these are the hours that you are contracting me to work, whether you're salaried or hourly, doesn't matter. And you say, during these hours, as I'm on your turf, you know, our contract holds. But when I step off of your turf and I'm in my private hours, that contract, you know, is not important. But in a marriage, you don't have that. You don't have that sort of ability to say, here's what the contract stipulates. And no, it's a covenant. It's a promise. So you dive right in. Contracts are about acquisition. Okay? You're acquiring something. Status, a material good. You're acquiring something, and you're doing this exchange process. Whether a covenant, on the other hand, is about an other-oriented relationship with the person. Back to Vesna and I. When Vesna and I were falling in love, and we were doing things together, and we were encountering one another and building that level of trust, notice the word I'm talking about here a lot, trust. While we were building that trust, we realized that our relationship was going to work a lot better if we began to see the other person as a complete and whole individual, and that we are there largely to share in life together. And so covenant is about reaching out to the person next to you and entering into this far more messy thing. Contracts are supposed to keep things clean, neat, and tidy. Every possible outcome has been accounted for in the contract. And if it hasn't been accounted for, we say that, well, that wasn't a very good contract. In marriage, you don't think, well, what about this policy, this policy, this policy, this policy, this policy, and write it all out and sort of own it. So, in addition to contracts and covenants, we say contract is all about self-interest over and above the other party. Covenant is about protecting the integrity of the relationship that binds both parties together. You see the difference there? Are you guys following? Read that again on the screen with me. Contract is all about protecting your self-interest over and above the other party. Okay? We believe that there's a good chance we might be taken advantage of. And therefore, we go out of our way to protect our self-interest. Covenant, on the other hand, says, hey, this relationship matters so much that we must look out for each other. So a contract, by definition, oftentimes, whether or not you say it, it has an element of mistrust, while as a covenant has an element of trust. We've covered this territory before together, but I thought it bared repeating so that we could understand, those of you that are entering marriages or that are in marriages, and you're thinking to yourself about the marriage in sort of a contractual way, I want to invite you to abolish that myth in your mind. And choose instead to see your relationship as one based on trust. So, truth number one, marriage is a covenant designed by God. So I've got some action steps here. For every one of my myths, I'm going to give you an action step. For those of you that maybe are teetering on the edge of seeing your relationships as contractual obligations, a this for that sort of a relationship, I give you this, you give me that, I want to encourage you to do this. Build trust through honesty, and especially with follow-through. Okay? So what does that mean? It means that as you're going about life together, and you're having these communications and these conversations and these experiences together, be sure that you acknowledge that you're doing this with somebody else, and that that person's experience is wholly dependent on the degree to which you recognize it. If you're in fact doing things together. Follow me? If you say, hey, we're going to the park together, okay, I'll illustrate this. You say, hey, let's go to the park together, let's go for a walk, okay? And you arrive at Queen Elizabeth Park at the main entrance, and you sort of look at each other, and you go separate ways, okay? Does that qualify as a, by the way, we traditionally would define it as a walk together in the park? Does the word together really have any significance at that point? No, I mean, you're on the same turf, but chances are you've got your own earbuds in, listening to your own podcast, your own audiobook, your own music, and you're going, and you're on the same ground, but you're not really acknowledging one another's existence, and the fact that maybe your walk through the park will actually be helpful if you do it together. So a covenant relationship, or one that's built on trust and mutuality, is one where we say, hey, we're going to the park together. Together. And that together means that I'm going to acknowledge your space and presence, and you're going to acknowledge my space and presence, and we're not together walking, but we are together walking. You know what I mean? Say, like, we're not one person walking, we are two people walking, and we're creating a space together and walking that park together. And that's just a metaphor for all of life, for your finances, for your careers, for various things. There is a degree through which you do it together in an honest sort of way. Okay, myth number two. Myth number two, and I just want to make sure the sound guys have sound coming up from the screen up front, because I'm going to play a little video clip here. Myth number two is this idea that marriage completes you. So I want to show a little funny clip here with this next video. It's 55 seconds.
We live in a cynical world. A cynical world. And we work in a business of tough competitors. I love you. You complete me. And I just... Had.
Shut up. Just shut up. You had me at hello. You had me at hello.
right. This is the famous movie Jerry Maguire from the mid-90s. And, of course, can I back it up one slide, please? There's that famous line, right? You had me at hello. But what actually precedes that line, you had me at hello? No, no. What was the line that preceded you had me at hello? It was Tom Cruise. You complete me. Now, this is a huge affront to all the single people in the world who choose to remain single at any given point in their life, for us to suggest that a human being is incomplete unless they're married or have a partner in life is just simply not fair. So can all the single people say hallelujah? All right. Marriage is not some way to look at somebody and say, you know, I'm not these things, but if I marry you, maybe I'll be those things, and I'm incomplete, I'm not a whole person, I don't have all the value in life that I could have unless I marry you. Now, this is why I call this a myth, is because many of us approach our relationships to our significant others, or even our best friends, maybe even our children, and we have this unhealthy relationship that some way, somehow, we might live our life through that other person. And what you end up doing is this myth sets you up for severe disappointment. Do you know why it sets you up for severe disappointment? Is that no human being can complete you. There's no human being that can complete you. You are already complete. You are complete in and of yourself. Man and woman were already created in the image of God. Okay? And the healthiest relationships are the ones that come together recognizing that what they're bringing together are two whole people. Two whole people. If you have huge issues and you're looking to somebody else to fix those issues for you or to do the things that you've always dreamt you could do but have never challenged yourself or had the courage to do, and you're hoping to accomplish those things through somebody else, you'll still feel empty. And in fact, you'll put so much pressure on that relationship and so much pressure on that person to be the perfect person, to be the perfect person in order to complete you, to give you meaning in life, to fulfill all your dreams and fantasies. But that's not what marriage is about. Marriage is not about taking two broken things, although we may be on another level broken in that we're sinners and we don't do things perfect, but what I mean is two incomplete things, and then when they come together, they become complete. No, I want you to understand that marriage in Scripture is two totally complete things coming together to make something entirely new. Did you catch that? It's taking two complete things. They're already complete, but when you bring them together, it makes something entirely new. This is what God means when he says, therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife and they become one flesh. Some people take this phrase in the Scripture, become one flesh, and they believe in this sort of completing paradigm that without a significant other, I cannot be complete. Truth be told, what God had in mind with marriage was the idea that when two become one, that new oneness is not taking that other one part and that other one part and they sort of disintegrate and become nothing and you lose your identities. That's not what God had in mind. You don't lose your identity. You don't lose who you are. You take that already complete person and you take this other complete person, and when you bring them together, you are making something that's entirely other. Do you understand that? Me and Vesna as a relationship is not Stephen having lost his identity or Vesna having lost her identity. We take the very best and worst of what Vesna is, and I'm going to get to this best and worst bit in a second in light of contracts and obligations and the vows we make. Let me bring this all together in a second here. But we take the best and worst of Vesna, and we take the best and worst of Stephen, and let me tell you, there's a lot of best and worst for both of us. We take the very best, we put it together, and this new marriage, this new partnership, it creates new space and new experiences and new ways in which we now encounter the world. I still sometimes encounter the world as solo Stephen. She still sometimes encounters the world through as solo Vesna. But more often than not, we encounter the world together. And now we have this partnership, this relationship built on trust, where we say, you know what? This new thing together is great, and it's awesome, and it's full of energy, and it's full of power, and it's full of beauty and love, and it's teaching me stuff about life, and it's teaching you stuff about life. And together, we're having a new encounter with the world. They become one flesh. They become one flesh. Now, let me tell you how this works, okay? So I grew up in an Adventist home, by and large. When I was 10 years old, my mother converted, and like a good 10-year-old boy, I got baptized and converted and became an Adventist and instantly switched to Deer Lake School midstream in grade 3 or 4, I can't remember. So I grew up liking kind of more rock and roll music, and in the 90s, I don't know if like, I don't know what the clubbing scene was or whatever, and when I went to Berman University, I never went to clubs. Anyways, the bottom line is the only kind of dancing I know how to do is folklore, okay? Folklore dancing. Some of you know where this story is going. I only know how to do folklore. Have you guys ever seen what, like, Eastern European folklore, you know, like it's a bunch of guys holding hands and we do kolo and all these kind of like little fast steps, whatever, okay? That's the kind of dancing I know how to do. We wear hats, we bang our heads on the ground. I'm not kidding, I'll show you the video. So that's the only kind of dancing I knew. Vesna, on the other hand, was not kind of into grunge rock in the 90s. She was into hip hop. And she didn't grow up in a no dancing environment. She grew up in an environment where her mom was like, yeah, dance, 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 dance. And she was on Burnaby South's dance team, then on UBC's dance team, hip hop, etc. So my wife, before she met me, she only knew like R. Kelly and whoever those other artists were back in the 90s, you know, hip hop artists. That's what she knew. I knew grunge rock, Green Day, Pearl Jam, Stone Temple Pilots, okay? Those are the kinds of things I listened to. I was a guitar rock and roller, and she was a hip hop dancer. So, for a little while, we became quite conservative in our Adventism when we first met. And so the dancing side to Vesna was always sort of this past Vesna, okay? We have more recently been a little more liberated over the past several years. And so Vesna's love, this dormant love for dance, I hope it's not getting me fired, West Horace. her dormant love of dance has come back alive. This side of Vesna that brings her so much joy and so much, like, just she's just loves dancing, has come back alive. And so Steve Merkovich, who doesn't know how to dance and certainly, you know, feels very awkward being asked to dance in any sort of that kind of a way, I sit there and watch. I sit there and watch my wife dance. And it's cool, you know, but there's a part of me that's like super embarrassed. Like super embarrassed. Not in the like I'm embarrassed, but it's just like me, like what is everybody thinking about me? I'm totally confident with her. She likes what she's doing and she doesn't care. But me, this is that to become one. She's independently doing something. She's not dragging me into it. She's not pulling me into it. She's just dancing on her own. But because of our one flesh idea, there's a way in which now I'm experiencing even what she does independently. See what I'm saying? We're still independent people. I don't ever have to become a hip-hop dancer. She doesn't complete me. It's not like, wow, I hip-hop dance through my wife. No, I don't do that, you know? I don't feel that way. There's some sort of, I was empty and never knew how to dance and now my wife knows and therefore I feel complete. It's not like that. Instead, what it is it's me viewing this entirely whole, complete person who's got her own idiosyncrasies and things that actuate her and make her feel alive, and one of them happens to be dancing, and I watch and I experience, as a result of our one fleshedness and this growing level of connection that's a mystery and I don't totally get it, but I experience it, and I experience it in all kinds of ways. So this myth that we complete each other is just that, it's a myth. And if you approach your relationship in hopes of finding somebody that completes you, you're going to be sorely disappointed. What you want is somebody who compliments you, somebody who sees the whole you and loves the whole you. You see how a vow is different from a contract, or how a covenant is different? When we say our covenants in the traditional, for better or for worse, no contract says that. No contract says that. Contracts say, if it goes worse, this ends. Now think for a moment, Vesna and I, we were broke as a joke. Remember, we were 21 years old. We paid for our whole wedding ourselves. And we didn't have a place to go, but we had a friend, a family member who had a house in Black Tusk Village in between Squamish and Whistler. And says, oh, you could go stay in my house for free for your honeymoon. And we said, well, we're broke. We love Whistler. That's where we got engaged. It happened to be summertime, so it's not our favorite season at Whistler. But we had plenty to do, and we had a good time. But suppose we're driving back on the 99 Sea to Sky Highway, okay, heaven forbid. But suppose we had been driving back and it had been a rainy day and I skid out of control and somebody hits us, and just days after our wedding, my wife ends up in a wheelchair for the rest of her life. In sickness and in health. Most contracts give a way out for sickness, right? That's the way a contract works. Oh, this is not what I signed up for. That phrase, this is not what I signed up for, is to a large degree what keeps us from being agile enough to pivot as we are constantly changing. And that change might be a tragic change 5 days into a wedding, into a marriage. But you are saying for better or for worse, in sickness and in health. This is what separates a covenant from a contract. A contract is trying to find ways to get out. A covenant is saying, I'm going to make this work. Because I remember you when you were whole. And when I married you, I knew you weren't perfect. It was for better or for worse, and I knew there were some worse parts. Contracts are saying, I don't want to know about your bad stuff. Keep it away from me because it's probably going to keep me from making this deal. And because I probably know there's a bunch of bad stuff that might bite me, I'm going to write this super thick contract so that every possible thing that you might do, I can get a way out. Vesna and I never sat there and said, okay, if you do this, I'm out. If you do this, I'm out. If you do this, I'm out. We just didn't do that. That's not the way love works. That's not the way relationships work. We complement each other. We don't complete each other. So truth number two, marriage makes something entirely new. Not a completion, not two puzzle pieces coming together, although those metaphors may have some play somewhere down the road, but it's not like incomplete and incomplete comes together to make complete. That's the myth we're trying to bust here. Marriage makes something entirely new. So action step number two, okay? So if this is a myth that you've been existing in, and maybe you've been in a marriage for a few months or a few years, et cetera, and you're just saying, man, like, I thought I signed up for this, but it's just not what I thought I signed up for. I want you to take some time in the next couple of weeks where you spend time reaffirming each other's unique qualities and talents. Look at the person next to you and say, wow, they are a whole person. And I fell in love with that whole person. All their idiosyncrasies, everything that went on. Did I miss something? Oh, you guys are practicing. Is that what's happening right now? Are you practicing? I just don't understand the murmur in the crowd. Oh, no, I said over the next couple of weeks here. Action step number two, spend time reaffirming the unique qualities that each of you bring, that bring, by the way, there's all kinds of myths. I could have put up 30 myths, that whole, like, I can change you myth. Don't get married if you think you're going to change the person into what you want them to be. That, again, is built on this whole idea that you can complete me, and, well, you don't quite complete me, but if I shift this and shift this and shift this, you'll complete me. You can't change the other person. You got to accept them, the whole person, for who they are, and when you enter in, you're going to go through that journey together. By the way, if you're not able to pivot, and you think the person you married is going to stay static, etc. Imagine now me. You know, when Vesna and I were getting to know each other, the dancing thing was dormant, remember? Dormant. Now imagine she revives this thing, and I say, hey, I didn't sign up for dancing Vesna. I signed up for non-dancing Vesna. Okay? That would be an out. For some people that are looking for divorce, that are looking for the easy way out of a relationship, they'll figure out any kind of an irreconcilable difference. Which brings us to myth number three. Good marriages don't argue, right? Some people think that. Oh man, I believe that the best marriages, those excellent ones, those people don't argue. How many of you believe this myth, that somehow good marriages are ones that are absent of fighting? It's the opposite. Yeah. There's one thing I don't want to say. I don't want to say marriage needs work. I'm scared of that word work. Maybe it's just my own personal bias. A lot of people say that marriage takes work. And I get it, and I guess I kind of affirm it, but I would prefer to use the word attention. Think of any relationship in your life. Think of anything. How well your car functions over the years. If you totally neglect it, fail to do any sort of maintenance to your car, it'll fail. Same thing with your human body. Same thing with your best friend. Suppose you have a best friend and you just fail to call them for 6 months. Well, are they still your best friend? No. So you can see having to call them, or you can see maintenance on a car as work, and you can see your relationship like date night. Oh man, gotta go to work. You can see date night as work if you so choose. You know, knock yourself out. If that's your metaphor and it makes it work for you, you could choose to see it as work. But I choose not to see date night as work. Amen? I don't choose to see communicating with my wife as work. I don't want to say, oh, I've got to have that conversation with her. Blah. I don't want to see the things that maintain a relationship, the attention that a relationship needs. I don't want to just chalk it up as work. And some of you love your work, and I happen to love my work, but that's the other thing. I don't call pastoral ministry work. I call it a calling. A calling. I try not to say, oh, what do you do for a living? Well, I guess I do it for a living, and I can't totally deny that, but I'd probably be doing something else if I was just working for a paycheck. Amen? For those of you that don't know what pastoral ministry is like, most of us are in it because of the calling. We're not in it for the paycheck. So your marriage needs attention more than it needs work. So this myth that you never argue or that you don't take the time. No, good marriages have disagreements. Remember, you're a complete person and another complete person. And those complete people come with ideas, they come with opinions, they come with ways they do things, and so does the other person. And unless you honor the fact that it's another complete person, you're gonna nag and nitpick, and you're going to argue in all the wrong ways. And you're going to be working at it and working at it, but that working at it is just going to make things more exacerbated. Your marriage needs attention, like your best friend in your car. And I don't want to seem like I'm, you know, your spouse is not a car. Moving along. Truth number three. Incompatibilities or differences don't destroy a relationship, okay? Incompatibilities or differences don't destroy a relationship. It's how we work through our differences that counts. Do you hear that? It's how we work through our differences that counts. So, action step number three, fight fair, okay? Fight fair, which means no criticism. Do you know the difference between a complaint and a criticism? Complaints are okay. Complaints are okay. Complaints is saying this specific behavior in this specific time irked me. Criticism is you're a lousy good for nothing, and you know, by the way, I hate the way you do the dishes. So criticism is contempt towards the person, not the behavior. So behavior, complaining or fighting fair is saying, by the way, Steve, you know, I'm not really fond of you leaving your socks on the ground, as Vesna had to tell me time after time after time during our early part of our relationship. And I had to say, Vesna, I don't like all your hair on the ground, right? Because, you know, women, hair in the bathroom, I said, I don't like that, right? but what we don't say is, you're a sloth, you're lazy. So that's criticism, that's contempt. You know, which is going to get me what? I'm a sloth, I'm lazy. So we've learned to fight fair. We've learned to fight fair. We've learned to say, you know what? The way we need to address this is by saying, you know, your behavior of leaving the socks on the ground or not vacuuming them up or sweeping up all the hair at the end of your situation where you're combing your hair. It takes a long time, Matt. My hairstyle, you know how long it took me this morning? 10 seconds. 10 seconds. I know it might look like it. Sorry, I don't look quite as put together as some of you. But action step number 3, fight fair. Okay, we're going to wrap this thing up. Marriage is full of surprises. No two marriages are the same, so you've got to learn how to fight fair. You've got to learn the fact that this complete person, you think you might know them when you're married, but man, I'm 12 and a half years into marriage, 15 years into a relationship with Vesna, and we're constantly learning stuff about each other. The good ones have some things in common, marriages, that is. I'm going to invite the worship band back up as we close here. I want to use an illustration of the value of Christ in the midst of a marriage. As Christians, we believe Jesus and his kingdom values should be at the center of every relationship. How many of you are familiar with this architectural paradigm? What a keystone is, right? So on the left and on the right, we have a series of kind of facing each other. And that's what you guys are, right? In your individual relationships, again, whether it's your best friend or your marriage, you are kind of facing each other and you're trying to have some level of like looking at each other and doing things together, right? But you kind of would fall in on each other selfishly if you try to complete each other, right? You try to come together. So what they did is they put this wedged in piece here called the keystone, and this keystone comes in between the two of you and becomes a part, it becomes a whole. You know, we don't say there's an archway plus a keystone brick. We don't say it that way. We say, oh, look at that archway, and we identify that part of the archway is this keystone brick. And this is what Christianity does when we say Christ is at the center of healthy marriages. Okay, so you might have the mythological view of Christ being at the center of your marriages where you just sort of call on him when you need him. But that's not what it is. What it is this invitation to say at all times, at all places, wherever we are, we need you at the center of it. So the myth is that we can just call on him to rescue us when all is falling apart. Some of you got married by a Christian pastor at the altar. And I can almost guarantee you, because I've done so many weddings, that 90% more, like nearly 100% of those marriages, the pastor will invoke Christ's presence to be a part of that marriage. Am I right or wrong on that? How many of you have been to enough Christian marriages to know that the Christian pastor, by definition, asks and invites and invokes that God be a part, that Christ be a part of that marriage? Some of you are going through life again as though the keystone was gone, and you're wondering why your marriage is crumbling in on itself. You are this strong brick-like structure on one side and strong brick-like structure on the other side. But when you try to meet, you're doing it based on contractual things, based on selfish needs. I need you to hold me up. No, I need you to hold me up. No, you'll complete me. No, I'll complete you. No. And all these myths that are getting in the way of you being able to have a healthy relationship. And by and large, the myths of the marriage that completes itself or the marriage that ends up on the grounds of a contractual obligation rather than on the grounds of a covenant promise, those marriages are the ones that have chosen to forget the keystone. It's the keystone, Christ himself, that reminds us what covenant love looks like at the cross. Husbands, love your wives just like Christ loved the church. Wives, submit to your husbands just as Christ submitted himself to the cross. This mutual submission and this mutual caring, play some music for me. Thank you. this mutual caring is taught to us. The reality that marriage is a covenant is taught to us by Christ. The fact that we don't complete each other, but that we are whole people, is taught to us by God. I want to invite those of you that whose marriages are starting to crumble in, and you're trying to complete each other, and you're not fighting well anymore, and you're not fighting fair, but your fighting is full of contempt and criticism and stonewalling and defensiveness, all these things that destroy marriages. I want to invite you to ask Christ back into the center of your relationship. He will teach you the way to look after one another in a caring, loving, kind, considerate way. He will teach you to honor the person next to you as a whole, caring, awesome, loving, amazing human being that you get to explore for the rest of your living days, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health. Don't take that chance that maybe they're going to be in a wheelchair to say, oh, well, we can't do the adventures. Man, there's so many adventures that you're going to now get to be a part of that you would have never gotten to be a part of had they not ended up in that wheelchair. And I'm using the wheelchair metaphorically. Illness comes, sickness comes, financial ruin comes, and you might look at all of those things as, hey, this is my out, right? See in my prenuptials, see in the way I viewed this as a contract, here's my out. I'm getting out of here. I want to invite you to ask Christ back into your relationship so you can figure out a way through it, not a way out of it. All kinds of myths that are demolishing relationships, damaging relationships. I invite you to see them the way Christ sees them.
Let's stand together.
life is cold, there is a promise. You will never go without love. There is love. In love, there is love.
Every morning. Thank you for your grace that covers over a multitude of errors. We love you. Give us strength to love you more. Amen.
You guys can take a seat. Well, I just want to welcome you guys to Oakridge Adventist Church. My name is Brendan Zapatichny, and I'm the communications intern here. And I've been looking outside the entire time, and I'm glad that you guys still decided to join us, even though there's such beautiful weather today. So I really want to encourage you guys to get outside like I have been all week. So I just want to invite the ushers up right now as I just tell you guys about a few things. First of all, I want to tell you guys three ways that you can give here at church other than this that we're going to do right now. First, we have something called text engagement. You can grab your phone out and text OAC Vancouver, one word, to 77977. You'll receive a text back with the link that you can click to then give right after that. Also, we have the giving link on our website, which is right there, and all you have to do is go to churchofvancouver.ca and go to the giving page, and that's pretty much it. It just gives you secure giving, and it's right there. Also, we have our app that you can give as well, and there's an option if you just scroll down, it'll say give and click on that. And that's just another easy way that you can do that. So right now we're just going to pray for the offering. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I am just so thankful to be in this room right now with these people and the opportunity to hear your word that Pastor Stephen has given us today about what a real covenant is, God. And I pray that for this blessing upon this offering as well, that we can give to this church in a way that we believe that of these relationships here, and that how we can give not just ourselves, but just through how we believe in this church, God, and what you are working through us. So thank you for this weather and this day and this Sabbath that we could rest and celebrate you here together, God. Amen. As they collect offering, I just have a few things to tell you guys. First of all, if you are new to this church, if you are visiting first or second time, we have something called 7 minutes or less, and we really would love to get to know you and tell you more about our church. So if you have a little bit of time, 7 minutes after the service, come join us on this side, the first two rows, and our wonderful people, Karen and Phil, would love to meet you and give you a gift bag. And just stick around. As well, if you heard last week, we said that we have something called Healthy Brain. Arlene Taylor was going to come visit us and give us a few words on the brain. Sadly, she became ill. And she had to cancel next weekend. So just take note of this. We are not going to be having our programming for next week, but we will have a regular service and everything else. Also, this week is going to be the Think Green Supper Club. And I'm very excited because we're going to have Asian cuisine there this week. So please join us, and you can learn a few secrets about how to make your favorite plant-based things there. And please actually RSVP on the meetup page if you can, if you want to make it. Also, we're going to be bringing back our new members class. And if you don't know about this, if you are, every few months our church offers this. And what it is pretty much introduces you to the idea of what we represent as a church, what goes on in this church, how it works, what we believe in, and everything across the spectrum in that way. And we'd love for you to come if you're a new member, if you've just been baptized. And just to teach you about our culture here at OAC. And that's it. I'm really glad to see you guys today, and thank you for coming to Oak Ridge.
All right, so that's April 23rd, after the service, new members class. We have some food. So if you're interested in becoming a member, that doesn't equal baptism. It just means you want to either transfer your membership here, or you've been recently baptized and you do want to become a member, we invite you. April 23rd, there will be some food involved as well.
I just want to do a big shout out to all our online viewers. It's the normal places, okay? It's the places we've grown to expect: Germany, Quebec, Ontario, places in the States, places in the Lower Mainland. We want to welcome you. Thank you to our online viewers. You are a part of our community. Oh yes, we need to do a membership second reading. Joash and Neema. How many of you know who Joash and Neema are from Tanzania? Of course. I don't know why this has taken so long, but they are, this is the second reading of their membership transfer from University Church in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania to OAC. So at the second reading, we actually take a vote. So can I have a first? Actually, this is the first. Can I have a second? Second. All in favor of transferring this membership here to OAC, we want to welcome Joash and Emma, even though they've been a part of our community for a while. We want to welcome you to full and official membership here at the Oak Ridge Adventist Church. So to my left, just a quick reminder before you jet out the doors, if you're new to our community and you want to know more, we want to get to know you better. We want to give you a gift, 7 minutes or less, right here to my left. If you want some prayer, come up here to my right, and our elders will pray for you, whatever's on your mind. And God, I just pray a blessing on this congregation. I pray a blessing on the marriages, and I ask you, Father, to intervene, to remind them of how much you love them and how desperately you want to be a part of their relationship. We pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Enjoy the day.